Welcome back, AP. Welcome back to it. Welcome back to your summer flip classroom abroad, right? Really, really interesting little thing going on right now. I'm actually sitting in Amsterdam, all right? So, like, sitting in my hotel room, which is the call for this, like, weirdly weird backdrop, because it's really bright outside, and I won't be able to see you otherwise, right? So, the big thing about it, though, is, like, yeah, I'm sitting in the Netherlands right now, and I'm on this scouting trip for our summer, summer study abroad trip that's coming up, you know, summer of 2024, that last week of May, that first week of June, where we'll be going to Paris and Amsterdam. If y'all are interested, it is not required that you go, but, of course, it's a great time to look at all the stuff that you might see.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Took all those pictures and stuff like that while I was on these different trips and tours and like different things that I was kind of checking out for the trip in general. But the big thing about it though is we still have summer assignments to do. So even though I'm on this scouting trip and stuff like that, I told myself, I was like, I got to record at least one flip while I'm over there to stay on schedule, right? So make sure that you're doing the same thing. Stay on top of your work, stay on top of that schedule, stay on top of that summer assignment, and this thing becomes a lot easier to bang out, right? But let's go ahead and get right back into the content where we left off. And also, by the way, a quick little side note, if at any point during the year, whenever we come back from like the school or from summer and stuff, if y'all want to kind of get in my ear and ask me some questions about the trip before you and your family decide to commit to it, let me know. I'm always open, and I don't have an S period this year, so you are more than welcome to knock on my door at any time, as long as there's not a sign out there that says I'm flipping, because if I'm flipping, I got to do what I got to do, and I got to record some lessons and stuff like that. But the big thing about it though is let's go ahead and bang this thing out, because I still got more stuff I want to go out there and see in Amsterdam, even though I've been here for a couple of days and seen so many cool things. Saw this, or like went on this really cool walking tour that we're all going to go on. Very, very excited about it. But let's go ahead and leave off, or like get back into where we left off when we were talking about the feudal system. So the thing about it is we were talking about the feudal system and its rise during medieval Europe, right? We were talking about the idea that the Vikings were raiding and the barbarians in the wake of the fall of the Roman Empire were causing a lot of confusion and a lot of like really, really, really like fear that just kind of was sweeping all over the continent. Mainly that fear was residing in the lower levels of the lords and the vassals and the serfs and the kings wanted to figure out a system to try and keep those people protected to keep an economy of some type rolling. So the thing about it is that the feudal system is going to be established and it's going to stick around in Europe for a long time, y'all. You got to understand that the feudal system, which is basically a system of economic slavery, is going to exist in Europe from right around the turn of the like century in about the 1000 like AD all the way up until about 1700s, all the way to the 1800s. By the time that Russia finally gets rid of feudalism, it's 1861. I want you to wrap your head around that. We're starting our civil war in the United States to rid the country of slavery when Russia just got rid of their economic slave system in 1861. That's bananas, right? So the big thing about, though, getting into it is you also got to understand one key thing. Looking at this feudal diagram, you see the kings are at the very, very top, right? You see the kings are up there in that little brick, all up there by themselves, looking like they're the most powerful. But an interesting little thing that you need to understand is that kings actually during the Middle Ages were surprisingly unpowerful. They were surprisingly weak, all right? They had a lot of different kind of like elements to them that didn't like really provide them, or actually they didn't have these elements that provided them with a lot of power. Kings didn't really have really good road systems. They didn't have postal services. They didn't have really efficient ways to collect taxes. So the problem was is that they actually fell kind of weirdly under the power of lords and nobles. And we can see this in one prime example, and it's highlighted in red for a reason. Because every single child that has ever had my class in at Chappelle, around me, near me, at any point in time impossible, will talk about this document that I'm about to chat with you about real quick. And it's known as the Magna Carta. Now look, the thing about it is the Magna Carta is so important that every single time I say it, you all in my class are supposed to exclaim an excited yay. You were supposed to freak out. You're supposed to be like, oh my god, yay! Ah. You don't have to say, oh my god, yay. You literally just say, yay. Don't give me like a yer or a woo. Like none of that, all right? Yay. Y-A-Y. It must be a yay. So if I were to say the Magna Carta,
yay!
Exactly, right? You got to understand that little system because it helps embed this document into your brain. But the thing about it is why when we were doing the Faculty Follies last year, when Mr. Terry was up there eating donuts and stuff and he walked up to the microphone and said that word, did the entire gym freak out? Well, let's talk about why that is. You have to understand what it is, what that document is, what the Magna Carta is actually the very first document, or excuse me, very first constitution in Western civilization's history. What it was actually when a band of nobles in 1215 AD, you might want to jot that down, 1215 AD, very, very important year, actually banded together, raised armies, and went up to the King of England, who was King John at the time, and forced him to sign a document that gave them better representation, laid the groundwork for the parliament, and actually limited the power of a king, right? And what's going to end up happening is because of this, England's never going to have an absolute monarchy, and the king will actually fall slightly under the power, and their power will be limited. Now, why do we talk about this document all the time? Because the only reason the U.S. Constitution exists is because of the Magna Carta. Yes. All right. So you have to understand, the only reason it exists is because of the signing of this document. When a bunch of nobles got together and forced the king of their country to give them proper representation in the government, and then also establishing some new rights, and also establishing the fact that the king could not imprison people without cause, could not strip land or territory or items without just cause, and that everybody was entitled to a trial by jury, also known as habeas corpus, or having the body of proof. So the thing that you need to understand is that the Magna Carta is going to set through a wave of different changes and things like that, especially in England, and ironically enough, this document or a style of document like this doesn't exist in places like France, Germany. Well, Germany didn't exist for a long time, but France, Spain, Italy, and a lot of these different areas that ever actually gave people more rights, and it's going to lead to the rise of absolute monarchs in about like the 16 to 1700s. So the thing that we also need to understand is that this document is so insane because it demonstrates how the lords and nobles during the Middle Ages and Renaissance will actually have more power than kings and rulers kind of will in an essence. Because if a king ever wanted to go to war, he had to call the nobles for help, right? If a king ever died, the lords and the nobles would be the next family that would be picked from and stuff like that if the succession crisis or if like the king died without a son. So something that you have to understand is that that document is super important, and it demonstrates to us that lords and nobles had a ton of power, and it also demonstrates to us as well that there is some want for some representative governments, and also the idea that constitutions will make their way into society following the Renaissance and the rebirth of society. Now, the thing about it that we now got to get into is we've got to talk about what's going on all up in here, because this map of Europe does not look much like the map of Europe that you've been looking at whenever you're doing your summer assignment, right? You're looking at a modern political map in your summer assignment that's got Germany and Belgium and Luxembourg and all these different areas that don't exist on this map yet. It's also got places like Holy Roman Empire in place of Germany. There's no Liechtenstein. There's also, at this point, no Austria, which is a little bit weird. So this is actually a medieval map. So what we need to understand, though, is that's what the map we're looking at during the time, during the, during the high and late Middle Ages, or there we go, the early and high Middle Ages. So the early and high Middle Ages have one common set of themes in mind, right? The thing about it is that their largest common theme that they share is that there's a lack of innovation. That's why I have the light bulb and the thumbs down. So some people, like medieval historians, would heavily disagree with me on this. They would be like, oh, what are you talking about? The late Middle Ages, or the high and early Middle Ages were so blah, 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 blah. I disagree. I disagree because literacy rates were extremely low. I disagree because we've lost a ton of history to these time periods. I disagree because mathematical and economic advancement were not that high. And also, I disagree as well when we look at things like art and their like subject growth. Now, a lot of medieval historians would argue with me that architecture is kind of like the art form of the Middle Ages that demonstrates its power and intelligence, which I'll have that debate with you. But the big thing about it is that we're having limited innovation. Also, we're having not very much money, right? Low economics is a very, very big theme of the early and high Middle Ages. Now, a lot of people ask me, though, they're like, well, in comparison to what? Well, that's the thing that you need to understand is this is all in contrary to what's going on in the East, right? So when we talk about the Western world, Western civilizations, we're talking mostly about Western Europe, places like France, England, Ireland, Norway, Scandinavia, like areas like that, okay? And then all of the impacts that they're going to have all over the world, including the colonization of North and South America, including their colonization of Africa as well later on. That's all activities of the West. Well, in the East, you've got places like Asia, Southeast Asia, India, the Middle East, which is also known as Southwest Asia. You've got Northern Africa, East Coast Africa, basically all the areas that surround the Indian Ocean. Now, from 500 AD to about 1450 AD, notice I got AD and CE, just in case you ever see either one of those date systems pop up, the Eastern empires were killing it, okay? Places like Southeast Asia, China, Japan, well, the Koreans at the time were a part of the Chinese Empire, but still, Africans, Arab communities, these different areas are actually growing super, super fast and making tons of money and going through what many people would refer to as a golden age of art, literature, and trade. Now, the Indian Ocean was a trade hub during this time period, and with little to no involvement of Europeans because they were actually going through their medieval era. Europeans had no access to the trade routes that the Easterners had. They had no ability to get there, and even if they could get these items from these people, from these Easterners, it would be far too expensive for them to be able to afford, and so the only people that would be able to actually afford them would be the nobles or the lords or a king or somebody that had a lot of money. And we'll talk a little bit about that as well, like as we keep going, whenever some of these items start trickling in to the Western areas, right? But the Eastern territories of Southeast Asia, Africa, the Arab communities that were killing it, when like a lot of people refer to the Middle Ages as a dark age, right? We'll talk about how that's not necessarily true. But like if you were to call the Middle Ages a dark age, you would call the Eastern territories during that same span of 1,000 years a golden age, because they're trading things like silk. They've got intercoastal trade. They've got scientific advancement. Like the Chinese are going to actually invent gunpowder in about 900 AD, which is going to forever change the entire world. You've also got Eastern territories inventing the very first printing press, and you've got Muslims inventing the paper making process and refining it from like Egyptian papyrus making. You've got like large intercoastal boats being built that actually have like sails that are triangular that can sail in and out of the wind. And we'll talk a lot about that in the second half of this, you know, when we get into the exploration stuff, how the Europeans are going to learn later on during the Renaissance period from the Easterners how to sail really, really far away. And that's going to lead to some dingus named Columbus actually like accidentally like floundering his way into the North American continent. Now, also, you've got salt. That's a really big one as well. Salt became really, really important because without it, you die. And it was worth its weight in gold, right, actually. And also, a lot of it was coming from the African territories, especially Western African like empires that were importing it through the Indian Ocean and into other areas. Salt was something that they had that kept people alive, one. And two, it was used as a preservative. You could actually keep meat and fish and things like that from rotting so quickly if you actually bathed it in salt. Now, also, gold is a massive thing as well, also coming mostly from Africa at the time. Preservation of Greek and Roman teachings and artifacts, because it's something that you need to understand, is that actually during the 1450s, at the late end of the Middle Ages, starting at about 1100, there's gonna be these big wars called the Crusades, right? And the Muslim territories, because that's something big key right now you need to jot down, is that the Arab communities right here, as of about 610 AD, begin to convert to Islam, right? Like, so Islam, or they are Muslim people. So Islam is the name of the religion. Muslim is the name of a person that actually practices that. You are a Muslim if you actually believe in Islam, right? So the thing about it is, though, is Muhammad is gonna show up in 610 AD, and he's going to start this entire new religion, and it's going to be considered one of the major three monotheistic faiths. That would be, of course, of Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, right? So the thing about it, though, is that the Crusades are going to happen, a massive set of wars between the Islamic kingdoms and then also through the Christian kingdoms over the Holy Land, aka Jerusalem, and the territories that surround it. Well, the thing about it is, y'all, you got to remember, Jerusalem is right down the street from Constantinople, and when Western Rome fell, a lot of their artifacts, their intelligence, their ideas, the writings, the scrolls, the scripts, got shipped over to Constantinople and were held there. Well, when the Crusades roll forward and the actual Muslims take over Constantinople in about the Third Crusade, Fourth Crusade area, they start actually coming upon a bunch of these writings of people like Aristotle and Socrates and Plato. And rather than burning them, because the thing about it is the Muslims were going through an intellectual golden age, they actually looked at them, they read them, they translated them into Arabic, and they actually preserved them and kept them very, very safe. So the interesting part about this is that when trade recommences with the Easterners, the Europeans are going to get a lot of that intelligence back through cultural diffusion, and the Renaissance will begin. So there's that big, big element right there. Philosophy is going to be a big part of their area as well. Spices are going to be huge. The invention of algebra and the number zero are going to happen in the Eastern Golden Age. And you also to like kind of look at the expansion of the Muslim territories. Oh, pff, I got it right there. Islam and the Rise of Muhammad, 610 CE. I don't know why I did that to you. But anyway, but Muslim expansion and territory is going to be massive during this Golden Age and during their time period. And it kind of really, really serves as like a contrary to the Dark Ages that are going, well, quote unquote, the Middle Ages that are going on during the same time period in this area. So up here in like Europe, you've got the Middle Ages, but you've got that Golden Age happening for the Muslim and the Easterners during this time period as well. So look at their expansion, starting out in Saudi Arabia, eventually growing to what is now known as the modern day Middle East, all the way over to Pakistan eventually, and then into North Africa. So looking at this picture right here, you can actually see what I'm getting at. If you look at a lot of the different elements of architectural stylings that actually are happening in the Middle Ages, the only large-scale architecture you have is like Gothic architecture that's occurring in major cities like Paris or London or some of these larger cities and economic hubs. This, however, on the other hand, is just a city somewhere in one of the Muslim territories, and look at the architecture, look at the schematics, look at the symmetry, look at the use of geometric repeating patterns. This is going to demonstrate the Muslim growth and territory, and interestingly enough, we have elements of Muslim architecture still existing in the south end of Spain, because that's right. Something you need to understand is that as the Muslim territories grew, they actually expanded all the way into what is now known as modern-day Spain, right? So they like expanded all the way into northern Spain by about, like, give or take 700 AD. So there's going to be some Muslim influence of architecture in Spanish, like, kingdoms and Spanish areas and stuff like that. Also in the Portuguese territories and areas like that. So the thing that you need to understand is that's going to become really, really key later on as well, because we're going to see the rise of a couple of monarchs that are going to get fed up with this and try to push all the Muslim practitioners out of Spain during this thing known as the Spanish Inquisition and the Reconquista. But we'll talk about that a little bit later on as well when we talk about the rise of new monarchies, right? So the big question about that we need to ask ourselves is, so what was the late Middle Ages and the Renaissance then really truly about? So, right, when we're talking about, like, the stuff, when we're saying, like, the late Middle Ages, the Renaissance, the return of all these intelligence, when the Europeans finally decided to put their boots on, pull them bootstraps up, and start doing some things again, start making great works of art, start expanding their intelligence, and start doing all this other stuff. Well, the thing about it is, what you need to understand is it's really just a return of money. Like, so when you really, really look at it, the argument that really needs to be made is that economics boomed during the late Middle Ages and the Renaissance, whereas they were kind of floundering in the early Middle Ages especially, but then also kind of just barely getting back on their feet in the high Middle Ages. So you've got the growth, particularly of Italian commerce, finance, and banking that's going to be happening. That's going to lead ourselves into the Renaissance, because a lot of times you actually have to understand when you're talking about the Renaissance period, there are two phases of it. There's the Italian Renaissance, and then there's the Northern Renaissance. The Italian Renaissance takes place in, go figure, Italy, and the Northern Renaissance takes place in places like the Holy Roman Empire, France, what is now known as the Flemish territories, which I am sitting in currently in Amsterdam. And also, if you come to Amsterdam, you'll go to the Rijksmuseum, which is actually a Dutch museum of art, and it's really, really cool because they have, like, Renaissance pieces, and then also 1600, they have Rembrandt, Vermeer, and some of the ones that I threw up in that little transitional area, Van Gogh, they have a couple Van Goghs. So, like, now the big thing about it, though, in general, is that you're going to see the growth of commerce come back. Economies are going to rise. And you're going to see Middle Ages money kind of go away, and you're going to see the growth of more like Renaissance-style money making. Well, Middle Ages money, let's talk about the differences between that. During the medieval era, how did people make money and how did economies really work? Well, the thing about it is money was made through three primary different things, right? Taxation being the biggest one, which is where the kings and the nobles actually exacted their control over other people underneath them or people that owed them money for landholdings and stuff like that. And then you also have landholdings in general. Your wealth was primarily measured in how much land you actually owned. And then also trade. Now, trade was an interesting one because the trade actually happened mostly within your own country. And if you could afford really, really nice luxury items coming from the East, you got those. But most people couldn't, right? So the capital then is going to actually be reinvested. Now, this is a big part of capitalism in general. Capital, as like the lords and the nobles and the dukes and the barons and the kings of these areas made money, they took that money and they reinvested it into their property. And profits began to grow, and there was a gap between the wealthy and the poor, and it began to grow pretty rapidly. Now, this is all taking place right around the end of the High Middle Ages, right around like 1300 AD, give or take, okay? Right about like 1300 AD, and then going into the 1450s, okay? So the thing about it is, when we're looking at it, though, you also have the one chief reason why people are making so much money during this time period, and a lot of it has to do with these things called the guilds, right? You're seeing the growth of basically the infant and or baby middle class of Europe. The guilds are going to be really, really important to the High Middle Ages, and then also the late Middle Ages. So what is a guild in general? Well, it's this idea of making money not in feudalism. Okay, so like in the feudal system, you had your lords, your vassals, your serfs. It's all about growing stuff on this land and actually providing like food stores that the land can, the lord can then sell and then eat off of himself, and then he can pay his taxes with it, right? So the thing about it is guilds are a little bit different, because remember I told you about like 75% of all people in Europe were a serf at one time. Well, then an even smaller, a teeny tiny little baby fraction of those people were like vassals and nobles, not of serfs, but you know what I'm saying. A tiny fraction of the population was lords and nobles, and of course like 0.0001% is going to be the kings or the rulers of a place. So what about that other 25%? Who the heck are those people? Well, they're actually commoners and peasants. Now, commoners and peasants make up about like 20% of the Middle Ages society. Now, how did they make their money? Well, they actually could do a couple of things. They could work in a harbor, they could work inside of a city or a town and stuff like that. But a lot of them start realizing something for a minute, and they're like, wait a minute, why am I competing with this other guy that does the same job that I do, right? Why am I just going after him like this? Why don't we actually get together and form a council or a group that where we can then teach each other master works of our different items, and then we can also educate people underneath us, and we can grow this business kind of like an early labor union, right? So that's the way a guild works, right? A guild works is by the fact that people that did the same job started getting together and forming groups so they could regulate the price of their product and regulate how to train people to do the same thing, right? So right here we have a smithing guild that is actually working, and they're making armor. This master right here is actually teaching these two apprentices how to make this item, and if they exist under the guild, they all communicate with one another, and they decide how much to charge for their product, and they decide how to educate all the new people that are going to be coming into making this specific product, right? The thing about it is, though, is a guild is a big group of large professionals, skilled workers that unite to protect and set the price of their product so they can avoid unjust taxation and fines, right? And so the thing about it is, though, is this is a genius idea, because it's growing like a merchant kind of craft working middle class in the like late Middle Ages, and they're starting to make a lot of money. And if they're making money, then they can go out and buy some stuff. But the problem is, though, in general, is that they're still a little bit limited on how much money they can make right now, because a lot of the money is locked up in two different places, particularly in the feudal system under the lords and the nobles, and then also in the church as well. Like, because we'll talk about that here in a few minutes. When I say money is locked up in a place, money exists in a very different way during the Middle Ages than it does now. Like, we have paper currency now, which is actually basically an IOU or a banknote. It's saying that, hey, I promise this exists somewhere, right? It's kind of fake and not even real. So we'll talk about that a little bit in general as we get forward, but let's talk about like these two different types of guilds. There are two separate types of guilds that were on the rise during the high and late Middle Ages that are going to help stimulate the economy going into the late Middle Ages and the Renaissance. The two big types of them include merchant and craft guilds, okay? Now, out of these two, though, which are the ones you think are going to grow the fastest? Well, I'll go ahead and tell you, very good guesses all around. Callie Barber, I heard you in the back. Very good. Merchant guilds, right? Merchant guilds are going to be the ones that actually grow really, really, really quickly, because they're the ones that are going to benefit off the Easterners. The Easterners are already doing all this stuff. They're already trading all these different products and all these different items. They're silks, they're spices, they're different items that are moving through the Indian Ocean. Well, the merchants are going to be like, well, why don't we get involved in that? Why don't we start shipping in some of this really expensive stuff and selling it to these people that can actually afford it? So, however, almost all the wealth still resided, though, like I said, with kings, feudal lords, and the church, okay? Now, the merchant guilds are growing super quickly, like really, really fast, and the merchants are the ones who bring the products in. They're the ones who own the boats and a large, like, scale trading infrastructure that can actually move all this different stuff around, right? Now, how do they make their money? It's mostly off the importation and exportation of Eastern goods, right? Luxury items that they had at the time. So you got things like Chinese porcelain, which is going to be really, really big because it can retain heat really well. It's very good for cooking. And also, look how beautifully it's painted. You've got Chinese silk that's being coming in through the ports as well. And they're actually using it because where are they picking all this stuff up at? Now, that's a key little thing. Where are these merchants going? Are they going all the way to China and picking this stuff up? No way. They're not going that far because they can't. A lot of their boats can only sail in one direction by this time period, just due to the fact that the ships are like kind of like not really well made yet and things like that. But they can go to one city and get all these things because it's the end of an ancient trade route. Some of y'all have probably heard from human geography this thing called the Silk Road, right? The Silk Road was this massive terrestrial and aquatic trade route that went all the way from China all the way to India, and then it actually ended in a very famous city. Constantinople, right? It ended in Constantinople, now modern day Istanbul. So the guilds, the merchant guilds, just had to go to Turkey, which is on the edge of the Mediterranean, and bring these items back, right? Bring those silks back, bring those teas that are coming from China back, which is going to be a very, very big thing a little bit later on. And then from India, particularly in Southeast Asia, the big money maker, the one that made everybody so much money they didn't even know what to do with. These things called spices, right? Now, spices were phenomenally expensive during this time period, and most of the money that was being made off them was by Eastern traders, not by Western ones, because it got more expensive as it went, and you had to go all the way to Constantinople, or if you wanted to get it direct from the source, you had to go all the way to India to get it. The Westerners couldn't get there yet, right? The thing about it, though, also, as well, is that in the Netherlands, I learned this yesterday while I was actually here and stuff like that, in common colloquial Netherlands terms, there is a word to this day. They use basically what it means is an idiomatic phrase. An idiomatic phrase is like how we like say like goofy little things in America, like, oh man, I'm like so like blah. I'm trying to think of one. What's an idiomatic phrase that we use, an idiom that we use all the time? Like it's a phrase, like, oh, like if you were to say somebody's business went out of business, like, oh, it went belly up, right? It went belly up. If you said that to some foreigner, they would be like, why is business belly up? Like, so like, where's the belly of this business? It doesn't make any sense to them. Well, the thing about it though, in general, is that the Dutch have a phrase in their society to this day where they say something is not just expensive, it's pepperly expensive. Because during the Middle Ages and the like, during these like different transitional points throughout history, black pepper, having that on your table was like having a Ferrari in the garage. That's how expensive this stuff was, right? And it could add spice and different items to, or different taste elements to your foods, and it's what rich people had. Also, though, here's the other key reason why merchant guilds make so much money during this time period, and a lot of it has to do with this concept, warehouse inventory. None of this stuff goes bad, okay? Chinese porcelain's not going to mold. Silk's not going to go bad unless actually it comes into contact with water, right? And so as long as you don't get anything on it, it's fine. Tea can be like contained inside dry. The tea leaves can be dried and contained for years on end. And spices don't really go bad as long as they're not exposed to water or air. And you can just literally put them in crates and boxes, right? So the thing about it is these merchant guilds are making money off these items that just aren't really going bad. And they're not spoiling that. But that's all going to change, though, or weirdly change, kind of in the late Middle Ages. So something that we need to understand is that the late Middle Ages is going to be another very big transitional time period, because actually it's going to be an era fraught with terrible and tragic events. Now, the late Middle Ages is going to come along as economies are beginning to return. So in the high Middle Ages, you're seeing like merchant guilds and craft guilds rise up, and you're seeing economics come back to Europe, and you're seeing money come back into Europe, and you're seeing the church make fabulous sums of money, and lords and nobles are making more money off taxation systems and stuff like that. But then all of a sudden, a bunch of really terrible stuff all happened all at once in the late Middle Ages that is just like mind-boggling to think that the Europeans even survived them, right? Well, some of them didn't. Well, you're going to see climactic shifts, right? There was this thing during the like during the 1300s in Europe called the Little Ice Age, where actually temperatures went down by about a half a degree Celsius on average, which caused huge amounts of rainstorms and like long winters and like areas like crops died at like massive like different rates. Famines ensued from 1315 to 1317 in different areas, and these climactic shifts are going to heavily change the way that Europeans had to farm, but it's also going to make a bunch of people starve to death. You're also going to then see as well the famines of 1315 to 1317. You're going to see war between nobles, right? Huge wars that are going to happen between nobles as nobles and kings begin to kind of struggle over their power against one another. One of the biggest ones actually being the War of the Roses. I don't know if you've ever heard, maybe not. If you haven't, it's not a big deal. We will talk about them later on. But there's a very, very famous family from England, and they are the winners of the War of the Roses. They're called the Tudors, all right? Well, they're actually related to the Yorks, who actually won the entire thing. But there was this fight between these two noble families called the Yorks and the Lancasters, right? And the Yorks and the Lancasters fought because there was a succession crisis. What a succession crisis is when a king dies without any viable person like to take over for them. No child that can actually take over for them. And during this time period, it had to be a boy, right? And so what ends up happening is, I believe it's the Plantagenet dynasty dies off, and the Yorks and the Lancasters both claim the rights to the throne, and so they went to a civil war with each other for over a decade. And what ends up happening is the Yorks win, but it's called the War of the Roses because their royal crests both had on them a white rose for the Lancasters and a red rose for the Yorks, and so they call it the War of the Roses, right? So like now the big thing about that is it's going to claim hundreds of lives of serfs and peasants, commoners and vassals, because these two rich families are fighting over who gets to take over. You're going to see the Hundred Years' War breakout, which is going to be another massive one that happens between France and England, and it's a war that lasted for 116 years and actually has very famous figures that come out of it, including one and only Joan of Arc, who actually was inside of that, one of our patron saints of our school and the patron saint of New Orleans. And the big thing about it is that she actually fought and died in the Hundred Years' War in a city called Rouen, right outside of Paris. Now, there's also the Black Death, which is the one that y'all probably know the best, right? That's going to be the Black Death, like, plague of 1347. It's going to be the bubonic plague that was spread by fleas on top of rats all over these boats and ships. Now, you got to think about that for a second. Look at that connection, right? If economy is beginning to come back during the High Middle Ages, no wonder the Black Death spread so badly, right? Because all these new boats are beginning to move all over the continent and transfer some of these luxury items from the East around. Well, all these boats had rats on them, and all these rats had fleas on them, and these fleas happen to have Yersinia pestis, a bacteria that they actually had lodged inside their throat, and when they would bite a human being, it would, and they would like throw it up into them, and the Black Death or the bubonic plague began to spread very quickly. See, all like the economics increasing kind of led to a disease going like viral, like not viral, it's bacterial, but you know what I'm saying, like literally spreading all over the continent super, super quick. You also have another one too called Babylonian Captivity, where it was also known as the Great Western Schism, where I kid you not, y'all, I kid you not, from 1378 to 1414, there were multiple popes, all right? There were several different popes. At one point, there was at least four different people claiming to be pope, and there were wars between these popes, and, like, different, like, countries in Europe are going to, like, go out, like, and actually join up with them. We'll talk about that a little bit later on, but Babylonian Captivity, or the Great Western Schism, literally known as the time of multiple popes, right? And it was a big thing about it. There were two for a while, and then there were three, and then there was a whole other thing. But then you're also going to see the Crusades, which is something we talked about a little bit earlier, the holy wars that actually went on between the Christians and the Muslim empires. Now, the thing about it, though, is that late Middle Ages is going to cost a lot of people their lives. You're going to see massive amounts of death between wars, disease, like political struggle and strife, but something crazy happened as a result. Now, a lot of y'all are like, oh man, if it was all that bad, no wonder the Renaissance took so long to happen. No wonder the Middle Ages lasted 1,000 years. Funny enough, you'd be a little bit wrong in assuming that, because the thing about it is economies increased. They took a dip, all right? So, like, what ends up happening during the late Middle Ages is right around the era about, like, 1350, about 100 years before the Renaissance really becomes Renaissance-y, right around, like, 1450-ish, the early Renaissance period. For, like, 1350, the economy went, like, and it dipped a little bit, and then it went, yow, and it shot up tremendously quickly and actually, like, went through the roof. And a lot of it has to do with the fact that there's a lot of different elements that are going to happen due to these tragedies. One is going to be the disruption of the manorial system, and two is going to be disruption of the church. Now, remember what I said earlier is that most of the money during this time period was locked up inside of a couple of places, locked up in the hands of lords and locked up in the hands of the church. Well, the thing about it, though, is that if you've got a dip in the economy and a lot of people dying from wars and different nobles dying, well, what's going to end up occurring is that a lot of that money is going to start kind of being slowly released out into the economy. Now, some of y'all are like, well, why didn't they just print more money or something like that? But you got to remember, y'all, and you have to understand something. Money at the time was based in gold and silver, precious metals and things like that. So literally, money was a actual tangible thing. You could hold it in your hand. And so the thing about it is, if I'm a noble that's got tons and tons and tons and tons and tons of money everywhere, and I've got to spend some of that money to go out and buy goods and armor and things like that to go to war with, I got to pay these guild workers to go and do that, right? I gotta pay someone to make this stuff. If I'm the church and I wanna have, like, if I'm one of the popes and I wanna have a war with another one of these popes, and I'm, like, bringing in different money and stuff like that, and it's being pilfered out into society a little bit, that means that literal coins, actual money, is leaving my bank account and going into other people's. So you're seeing the money spread out. But some of you are like, but what about the Black Death? I thought a bunch of people died. Well, yeah, they did die, but that's the thing about it, is less people that are out there means that more money is ending up in individual pockets rather than being spread over hundreds of thousands of people. So the thing about it is less people and restriction leads to smaller markets, keener competitors, and higher wages and profits. So people are actually making more money after all these tragedies because they don't have to compete with as many people anymore. And so what you're going to see is the growth of new trade routes, new ships from Eastern influence are going to be coming around that have triangular sails that can sail into the wind and go further and stuff like that than like they had never gone before. You're going to see multi-level trade systems now as well, where you're going to actually have me, a merchant in one place, and then a merchant someplace else, right? I think we have like Olivia in this class, right? Olivia lives out in Norway, and then we got like who's somebody else that I know is in this class? I don't know. I can't remember. We're going to, like, just call you Susie, all right? So now, look, the big thing about it, though, is, like, you got me who lives in Italy, you got Olivia who lives in Norway, and Susie is going to be my middleman, a part of the Comenda system. Susie owns a boat, so I'm going to, like, pay Susie to take all of my items and ship them all the way up to Norway so Olivia can get them. Every single one of us is making money along the way because Olivia had to buy the products from me. I had to pay Susie to ship them. Susie makes money. I make money. Olivia makes money when she sells my goods back in her home area, right? So that's going to be a multi-level trade system. So instead of actually depending on one guy with a boat going all the way over there, picking up all that stuff, and if the boat sinks, he loses everything, you're going to actually see more distinct economies actually like pop up during in the wake of all these late Middle Ages tragedies. Like, that's a big thing we need to understand, that in the wake, and after all of these tragedies, you're going to see keener competition and better wage earning power come up. Family firms are going to pop up as well. You're going to see a lot of families that aren't nobles necessarily, or aren't like kings or queens necessarily. They're going to pop up particularly in Northern Italy. And you're going to see one famous one called the Medici, if I can get to them during this flip. And if I can't, whatever, we'll like, you know, put them in the next one or something like that. We'll figure it out. Now, the big thing about it though, in general as well, is you're going to see the rise of new financial techniques. Also, you're going to see double entry bookkeeping pop up, which means that actually you're going to have two columns in a bookkeeping thing. All things in red are going to be things that he owes you a credit, right? Like, so, like, or you owe someone else. Everything in black means that actually you make it. And that's actually where the word debit comes from, because it actually comes from Latin, which means he trusts, or like, not he trusts, he owes, and I made that money. So, like, the thing about it is actually that's why we call Black Friday Black Friday, because in these double entry bookkeeping techniques that actually popped up in the late Middle Ages going into the Renaissance, all those like profits were actually coded in black. And so, the thing about it is in like on Black Friday, most businesses in America finally start making money right around November going into the Christmas season. And that's why they always call it Black Friday, because a lot of their books go into the black. So like now the big thing about it though, in the credits and loan systems are going to pop up, and we'll talk about that a little bit more as well. Bills of exchange, being able to track what you bought, how much you bought, like for tax purposes later on. Money lenders with interest banks or with interest rates, and you're going to see the rise of banks as well, which is going to be really, really big. Now the other quick question you got to understand though too is politics, like what's going on during this time period? What do things look like? Well, the government of the Middle Ages is still mostly held in feudalism, right? And this is mostly in Northern Europe, and this is beginning of nation states are going to be popping up as well. You're going to see like kings growing their land and their land holdings to larger areas that kind of like resemble the modern areas of France or the United Kingdom and things like that. But also the other big thing that you're going to see is that there's going to be one big competitor that sits out there with them. It's the church, right? And the church believed that it was the universal guiding government of the entirety of Europe. That papal supremacy idea where popes actually claimed power over kings is going to lead to a lot of strife going on in the 1500s. So something a lot of y'all are going to realize if you've never talked about it before is that the Renaissance and the Reformation are happening at the same time. Now the Reformation happens a little bit later, but like so the Renaissance starts around like the 1350s, but the Reformation is going to happen right after that because kings are going to be sick and tired of sharing power with all these popes. Now, also, the donation to Constantine is a big thing that the popes would always hang their hats on, right? They would always be like, remember that the Constantine wrote that letter that said that the pope is meant to be the guiding force in the former Western Rome, that the pope is supposed to be the leader. That one document kind of gave those popes that much power. And we'll talk about it a little bit later on. But this is a being like, is what the like most of Europe looks like right around the turn of the centuries into the 1400s and 1300s. But we got to focus our microscope in on one particular place. Italy. Italy is going to be the birthplace of the Renaissance. So while all this craziness is going on, especially in Northern Europe, while you got kings and lords going to war with each other, when you got literally in this area up here, you've got feudalism being the main economic factor of all these different areas. That's not the case in Italy, right? Especially not in Northern Italy. Because in Italy, you've got this thing where wars of controversy and the conciliar movement, like war and church controversy, are going to actually weaken the papal states to a degree, and their territory is going to retract a little bit. So you ended up with this little area, like right here in Northern Italy, that wasn't really controlled as much by the church as it used to be, right? And also the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies is the area in South Italy, which is super agrarian, where they can't really access it because they're on the other end of the papal states, right? Now, this lack of power left room for the growth of three key northern Italian city-states known as Venice, Milan, and Florence, right? So, like, now the thing about it, though, is that you have to understand is that these different areas are going to grow really, really quickly, and it's going to make these different areas and these different cities tons and tons and tons and tons of money. And a lot of it has to do with the fact they were established as Northern Italian republics. They were like actually started as not feudal systems. They were established as communes, right? And so the thing about it is that they were sworn associations of free men that regulated trade, collected taxes, and maintained city walls. And they grew wealthy, but they were very politically unstable. And a lot of it has to do with the fact that there was some strife between these two groups called the merchant elite and the popolo. But the thing that you need to understand, this last moment in this flip that you need to understand more than anything else, is that these northern Italian states, which we'll talk about in the next flip, is going to be Venice, Milan, and Florence. The big things about them is you really, really, really need to wrap your mind around, while Northern Europe is very feudalistic and very much like power is being controlled by the lords and the kings, and there's all this land that they have in acquisition that they tax and this entire system that they use, the northern Italian states are not going to do that. They're going to kind of like get rid of feudalism altogether, and they're going to establish these things called communes, right? And these communes are going to be free men that come together to that decide that they want to just create guilds that exist all over these cities and no feudal systems and no lords, right? And that these like sworn associations of free men would regulate the trade, they would collect taxes, they would maintain city defenses, they would do all of this without lords and without kings and stuff like that, and they would actually have more voting systems and stuff like that. So they grew very wealthy, but they were politically unstable because, as we always know, in societies, some people make a lot of money and some people don't make as much money. And the people that made tons of money were called the merchant elite. And the people that were a little bit lower than them in some of these communes were called the popolo, right? And so it literally means people. And they were like popolo grasso and popolo minuto and all this other stuff. But we're actually going to cut it off right there because I don't want your brain to melt out your ears and stuff like that. But the big thing about it is go ahead and get all this down. In about a week, I'll post another one. And we're going to talk about Florence and Milan and Venice and all these different areas that actually began to grow really powerful during the Renaissance era. And we're going to kind of keep going and talk about how they made all their money. So we'll talk about that soon. I hope y'all enjoyed it. I really, really look forward to hearing any of y'all's questions about the trip coming up. And I'm going to go hang out in Amsterdam for one more day before I head back to Paris tomorrow. But I'll see y'all soon. Y'all have a good one.